Pitchford, our lyricist, and Larry Cohen, who's written the book, who also adapted the novel to the screen.
The three of us have been working on the show for the last few years, and now, thanks to a very talented group of performers, it's on its feet for the very first time, in its first stages as a reading. What you're going to see and hear today will require your imagination. There are a lot of special effects in our show, thanks to Carrie's very strange gift. Lights explode, objects levitate, in the air, windows slam, lasers come out of Carrie's fingers. You get the idea. You won't see any of these. Nor will you see the choreography that's going to play a dynamic role in our musical. You have very 80s, very MTV style approach to dance in the theater. But what you will see in here today are the music and dramatic highlights of the first act of Carrie the Musical, based on Stephen King's classic novel.
In the early winter of 1972, a Maine housewife dusting her husband's makeshift study fished a manuscript out of the wastebasket and sat down to read it. When Stephen King returned from teaching high school English that evening, his wife Tabby persuaded him to resume work on the abandoned novel. Several months later, he submitted the revised version to Doubleday and Company. The following March, they published Carrie, a little novel about an ugly duckling who discovers in her unhappiness that she has a strange and wild talent, telekinesis, the power to move objects with her mind. The motion picture that followed was directed by Brian DePalma. On midnight of Halloween in 1975, we snuck Carrie in hundreds of theaters across the country. When the movie was released a few months later, Pauline Kael in The New Yorker called it the best film of its kind since Jaws, a teasing, terrifying, lyrical shocker. It went on to win Oscar nominations for Sissy Spacek in the title role and Piper Laurie as her fanatic mother. The prologue begins with the stage in total darkness. A single light, pin spots, 17-year-old Carrie White.
Be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy would.
Really?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Gardner now divides the class into two groups of six, and each group builds a human pyramid. Carrie, of course, is the last girl in her group. Nervous and clumsy, she manages to collapse her team's formation, bringing her furious classmates literally to their knees.
Carrie,
a
creep.
What a joke.
What a toad.
Carrie!
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 You eat shit.
We're all set upstage to the show.
Don't forget to stretch!
Never mind, Carrie. Go change up now.
And now we go to the girls' showers. One at a time, through the steam that partially obscures their bodies, the girls appear. They sing of their hopes and their aspirations, their secret thoughts, their dreams.
Saints and angels above me.
happening to her. No idea that this is her first period. She thinks she's bleeding to death. Panicking, she runs to the other girls, Sue and Chris among them, for help. The girls, in turn, treat it as a big joke. Laughing hysterically, they start pelting her with things, making fun of her, chanting her name. Hearing the noise, Miss Gardner comes in to investigate and is horrified to find Carrie huddled in the shower. She tries to calm the hysterical girl, but Carrie is out of control, crying, intensely frightened. Miss Gardner slaps her, and then something very strange happens. The light in the shower, right above Carrie, blows out. It almost explodes, momentarily shocking everyone. Miss Gardner helps Carrie off stage, and at that point we hear,
"Did you believe that stupid bitch bleeding like a stuck pig?"
"Yes." "Well, she was. Well, she was."
And now we go to the principal's office. Miss Gardner, still upset by the incident in the shower, describes it to the insensitive Mr. Morton. He really doesn't understand what she's talking about, and he even feels uncomfortable discussing it. But then he consults his files, and it all makes a little more sense to him. Carrie is the daughter of Margaret White, a religious fundamentalist who's considered more than a little strange by the community. Mr. Morton asks for Carrie to be sent in. Seeing the gym teacher and the principal talking, she hesitates in the doorway.
"Come in, Captain."
"Carrie."
"Miss Fish, would you bring in a dismissal slip? Thought you might take the rest of the day to go home. Take care of yourself, Cassie. We're all very sorry about this incident."
"It's Carrie."
"Would you like to go to the infirmary, lie down for a while?"
"I think Carrie can go home."
"You want to ride, Cassie? We could call her.
I'm sure she can walk."
"Call the fresh air." "That's right."
"And Carrie, you're excused from gym for the rest of the week. Take study hall instead."
"We're all very sorry about this, Cassie.
Let it die.
Carrie continues on her way home, and now the set changes to reveal the White home, where Margaret White sits at her old-fashioned sewing machine in this strange living room full of religious pictures and objects on the wall. And now the sounds of the Gospel Hour broadcast take over, pouring out of the radio, as we hear the Reverend P.P. Bliss and the Children's Choir for Christ.
Open your heart.
You're listening.
Begin!
And now we go to the local drive-in, where the latest teen horror movie is being projected to an audience of what appears at first glance to be empty cars.
You can slug just like a pro. Don't you ever say anything but no. Why did we come here? You're gonna fight.
We fight.
That's right, that's right.
Sure, screw romance. You're just trying to get into my pants. How can you ruin such a perfect night?
All right.
You might
not quite
see boys like you. You don't even care for love.
Me, that's not true. I never get enough.
Oh,
Too has a little shrine, a statue of Christ on the cross, a candle illuminating it. Margaret comes over and unlatches the closet door. Of Jesus in the portrait above it. Then gently she lowers it back to the mantle. The next day at school, we pick up in the classroom Mr. Fromm's fourth period English. Mr. Fromm is berating the class for the low caliber of their papers. Billy Nolan, for instance, didn't even turn one in. There is, however, one surprise.
There is, however, one small surprise, a poem that surprised me as much for its feeling as for its source. And I would like that person to recite his work for the rest of you. Tommy Ross?
Hey, college boy, way to go!
Hi, Mr. Nolan, if you have any more to say, down on paper. Tommy?
Do I have to?
Oh, come on, lover boy, let's hear your poem.
Another word from you and you can sit out the rest of the hour in Mr. Morton's office. Tommy, stand, please.
And he goes just another
things I feel and things I dream. There's more to me than I reveal. And though I shine in quiet ways, I'm someone you don't recognize. I am a diamond in the rough, a dreamer in disguise. An eagle's just another bird until it can spread its wings.
Thank you, Tommy. All right, class, comments. Come on, anybody? Carrie White. Could you speak up, please?
It was beautiful.
It was beautiful, just beautiful.
Shut up, you jerk.
Hey, baby, you fruit.
All right, that's it, Nolan. Down to the principal's office, on the double. I can't go on Tuesday class. If I were you, I'd finish the Scarlet Letter.
And now we go to the girls' gymnasium. Miss Gardner calls the roll and chews out the girls for their vicious treatment of Carrie. Their punishment is to be her exercise class, a grueling double-time period workout that makes the opening number, Ain't It a Bitch, look like a picnic. If the girls don't do exactly as she says, they'll lose their tickets to the prom. Grudgingly, the girls start the brutal workout. Midway, Chris Hargensen rebels and stops exercising.
The period's not up, Parkinson.
It is for me.
Keep going. There are 10 more minutes left.
Get them up your ass.
You'll get cancer for this, you bitch. My daddy's not going to say, you know what, Chris? Go on, put it. She can't get away with this. If we all stick together, Lorna, Helen,
now we leave school and we go to the Cavalier, the after-school hangout. While waiting for Tommy, Sue runs into a furious Chris.
God, Carrie, if only the rest of you had walked out. Jesus, Sue, why didn't you? What did she ever do to you, Chris? Or to any of us? Why do you hate her so much? Tell me if I'm wrong, but who was that in there? She stopped. God, I'm dumb sometimes. Hey, Billy. Hey, Billy, you want to know why Sue's here didn't walk out?
I'll see you around, Chris.
No, wait. You stopped, man. You just stopped. You didn't walk out, Sue. Little Sue, you cream cheese. Because you didn't want to miss a moment of your precious prom.
You don't.
You're goddamn right I don't. And I don't intend to. We're on your case now. I bet you got your dress all picked out too, don't you? What color is it? Yellow guts? Okay. See you around, Sue.
Hi.
Hello, Tommy. How you doing? I'm great, babe. Just great. You? Well, I'm on Mars. Hello. You in there?
Yeah.
Late night at the Cavalier, a night spot where the kids hang out. Sue wants something from Tommy, Chris wants something from Billy, and the number is called
do me a favor?
I don't know. Tommy, lately I've just not been feeling right. I'm so ashamed of how we've all been treated, Carrie. Why? Am I crazy? Am I sounding like a dope? I'd never dream of asking this, but you're my only hope. Do me a favor.
Thank you.
big silly. I want to show you something. Now look, that's a pretty girl. You have beautiful eyes. A little mascara could really bring them out. And your lips, the right shade of lipstick.
Well, why not? Isn't that such a big deal? Well, no, but my mother, she...
Get you the right dress, hair all fixed up.
Later that same afternoon, Tommy goes to see Carrie at her home, and at the front door, once again he asks her to be his date at the prom. This time he won't take no for an answer. Carrie is terrified that her mother will find her with Tommy, and coupled with her very real desire to go, she says yes. Tommy leaves, and Carrie goes in to dinner. We find Carrie and Margaret at the dining room table, in front of a religious wall tapestry. The table illuminated by candles. A steady drizzle outside can be heard throughout, punctuated by occasional bursts of thunder as a storm worsens.
Mama?
rays are coming through the open kitchen windows.
Stopping here at the end of the first act of Carrie. Act two has been completed, but we just wanted to give you the sneak preview of our show. As those of you who've read the book or seen the movie will remember, Carrie does indeed go to the prom. Her wildest dreams come true, but then Chris Hargensen makes good on her threat of revenge, and the dream turns to nightmare. Carrie becomes Cinderella, all right. Cinderella with a vengeance. The innocent schoolgirl becomes vengeful demon, unleashing the full arsenal of her destructive powers. The evening culminates in a mother-daughter confrontation that brings our musical to a spellbinding close. Thank you all very much for coming. There's wine and other stuff to drink in the back. Help yourself.